We are all unique. We have different personalities, goals, values, tastes, hobbies, sense of humor, and quirks. We feel we are the same person throughout our lives, something known as the self. But the perception of the self may be just an illusion. If anything is common across human personalities, it is the capacity to be continually shaped by the environment we inhabit. So, as the environment changes, we also change. We used to think of our brain as something immutable. We now know, however, that the brain is malleable, a concept known as brain plasticity. Unlike other materials such as concrete or glass, plastics bend when a force is applied. In a similar way, our brain changes in response to external stimuli. Only instead of physical forces, we are talking about our experiences throughout life, such as learning a new sport. When we learn a new skill, be it surfing, kitesurfing, a new language, or poi, our brains respond by forming new connections between neurons. The more we practice, the more the neural pathways involved in that activity are reinforced, and we get better, until we eventually become experts if we practice enough. It's similar to what happens to paths in the countryside. If a path is walked on often enough, it's maintained. But when it's no longer used, plants start growing, and little by little, it vanishes. If you want to explore a new area where there is no path, you start forming a new one as you go along. This is the first study showing in humans changes in the structure of the brain across time when learning a new skill. In this study, participants trained juggling for 3 months in a row, and after 3 months, researchers found increases in gray matter in this region at the back of the brain, a visual area sensitive to motion. What is remarkable is that this paper came out not so long ago, in 2004, and it changed the way we think of our brains. Before, scientists believed that the structural anatomy of the adult brain could not change, except for changes due to aging or neurodegenerative disorders. Since then, numerous studies have shown brain changes linked to learning a new skill, such as a new language or a musical instrument. Indeed, the more gray matter we grow, the better we become. But it's not only learning a new skill that sculpts our brain. Memorizing information, focusing on solving a puzzle, and integrating what we have learned also requires mental stamina and makes our brain stronger. Scientists have found that a higher level of intellectual activity is linked to a decreased risk of developing dementia. We don't know exactly why this is, but it could be because neurons are better preserved or because the brain is better at finding alternative routes when facing neurodegeneration. These hypotheses are not mutually exclusive, and there is scientific evidence supporting each, so it's likely to be a bit of both. Either way, it seems that keeping mentally active is a good thing. In general, exposing yourself to new experiences is a good exercise for your brain. One way of doing this is traveling. When we travel, we break away from daily routine. We look at the world with different eyes, with more curiosity. Everything is new, the places we visit, the landscape, the food, the people we meet. This forces the brain to be more alert and flexible in order to adapt to new circumstances, which is always better than letting yourself get bored by an excess of familiarity and routine. There is something else that keeps our brain happy and healthy: physical exercise. There are plenty of studies that show that physical exercise reduces the cognitive decline that comes with age. And there is evidence that suggests that this could be because physical exercise promotes the formation of new blood vessels and neural cells. In 1999, scientists observed for the first time that running stimulated the formation of new neurons in mice in a fundamental region for learning and memory, the hippocampus. This dramatically changed how we viewed our brain. Before the late 90s, scientists believed that neurons in the mammalian brain were not able to divide once developed. However, we now know that there are some primitive neural stem cells in some regions of the brain that can renew themselves and create new neurons and other brain cells. We don't know how exactly physical exercise promotes the formation of new cells, but we think that this could be thanks to the release of molecules such as the brain-derived neurotrophic factor, or BDNF for short. This helps neurons to survive, proliferate, and mature. But we don't have to wait until we grow old to see the benefits of exercise in our brain. Multiple studies have shown improved cognitive performance after physical exercise. Even 10 minutes of moderate exercise can make a difference in how well you perform in a cognitive test. And it's not only aerobic exercise, resistance exercise can also improve cognitive performance.
So a good trick is to have a quick burst of exercise before studying or concentrating on a project that requires all your attention.
The benefits of physical exercise on our brain health go beyond boosting our cognitive abilities. They also have an impact on our mental health. Exercising improves our mood, and in people suffering from depression, it alleviates symptoms, showing antidepressant effects. It seems that exercising not only makes us smarter, but also happier. If our hobbies and life experiences can change our brain, would what we eat also make a difference?
Nutrition provides the building blocks for the brain to create and maintain connections. For example, omega-3 fatty acids are essential for the structure of the neurons and the connection between them. The omega-3 fatty acid DHA is an important component of our neuronal membranes, but our body is very inefficient at synthesizing DHA, so we rely on our diet to get enough DHA. Studies in mice have shown that a deficiency in DHA decreases their learning ability and memory. In humans, scientists have found a link between a deficiency in omega-3 and an increased risk of disorders such as dementia, depression, and schizophrenia. Another component which is also necessary for proper brain functioning is folic acid, which we also get in through our diet. Deficiencies in folic acid are associated with an increased risk of dementia, depression, and a poorer response to antidepressants. So in order to get adequate levels of folic acid, we need to consume plenty of oranges, vegetables with green leaves like kale, spinach, or broccoli, and legumes like beans, lentils, or chickpeas. Another way our diet can influence our brain has to do with the chemicals that are used for neural functioning. Our neurons communicate with each other using chemicals known as neurotransmitters, and in some cases like serotonin, the levels of the neurotransmitters can be influenced by our diet. The amino acid tryptophan is a precursor of serotonin, so how much tryptophan we consume in our diet affects our levels of serotonin in our brain. And this is crucial since serotonin is involved in many functions such as mood, sleep, appetite and cognition. Some studies have found that higher doses of tryptophan in our diet are linked to less depression, irritability or anxiety.
So which foods are rich in tryptophan? Nuts, seeds, grains, chickpeas, milk?
But it's not as simple as the more tryptophan we eat, the more serotonin we'll produce in our brain. Tryptophan competes with other amino acids to cross the blood-brain barrier to reach the brain. So effectively, how much tryptophan arrives to the brain depends on the ratio between the tryptophan and other amino acids.
One way of getting more tryptophan to our brain is consuming food rich in antioxidants like strawberry, nuts and seeds, since they increase the flux of tryptophan into the brain and in addition they improve blood circulation and overall health. So it seems like a good idea. Another food that has antioxidant properties as well as anti-inflammatory and antibacterial activity is curcumin, the main component of turmeric. Some scientists believe that curcumin is part of the reason why Alzheimer's disease is much less prevalent in India compared to the United States. And they have reasons to believe so, since studies have shown curcumin stimulates the formation of new neurons, and in animal models of Alzheimer's disease provides protection against neural degeneration. In contrast, we know that diets rich in sugar, saturated fats, or high in calories are not good for neural functioning and cognition. It's not only a matter of what we eat, but also how much we eat. Numerous animal studies have shown that a caloric restriction has health benefits for the brain. Scientists think that having a diet low in calories may reduce neuronal damage and promote the formation of new neurons and connections between neurons, offering protection against neurodegeneration. Our thoughts, emotions, and memories all come from our brain, making us who we are. But our brain is not immune to external factors, quite the opposite. We've seen how our habits shape our brain. The things we learn, the places we visit, whether we exercise or not, what kind of food and how much we eat. All of this has an effect on our brain. This is fascinating because it means that we do have a chance of affecting our brains and minds. And even if there are things that are out of our control, we can always make a difference with our lifestyle. So, in a sense, our habits shape our brain and define the people we become. Thank you.